Hi, I'm Sarah Barrett-Neal, Gallery Manager for the Glen Arbor Arts Center. Today, I'm in conversation with Benzie County artist Jessica Coven, whose mixed media paintings are now on display in the Arts Center's Lobby Gallery. Hi, Jessica.
Hi, Sarah.
The name of your exhibit is The Birds Are Watching. What are the birds watching?
The birds are watching all of us. They're watching humans, they're watching what we're doing to their world and the landscape.
How do we see that? How do we see that the birds are watching?
You read my captions, you think about it, you look at the whole and you think about what am I trying to communicate? Why am I doing this?
This is such an evocative title. I'm just wondering at some point if it struck you in your watching of the birds, if you thought you were being watched back.
I think so. There's a piece of it about with all of nature feeling that way. I've given thought to the fact that because we use screens so much now, we have a lot of one-way communication happening. We're looking, it's a one-way gaze. Our gaze is one way, but we've lost sort of that two-way gaze. But when you look at an animal in nature, if you really make eye contact, you realize we're being watched. So it was that sense of, we're not just watching birds are watching us.
So much of your work I've noticed through the years, it's all very personal. There's lots of references to things that are happening in the world, both joyous and not so joyous. Generally speaking, the ideas and subjects you address in your work are often in response to social, political, and ecological issues, like the birds are watching. Lots of times people push back against using artwork for these things. I came across a quote by the poet Archibald MacLeish, and he said, I'm quoting here, "Artists do not save the world. They practice art, or they put the art aside and take a rifle and go out and fight, but not as artists." So talk about the ways in which you translate the world through your artwork and how it isn't separate from the events in your world.
I think that's a really good question. And it's actually one that I think about a lot. I mean, sort of what is the role of the artist? And I think of myself as an artist activist. And then you think, well, what does activist mean also? So both those questions, I would disagree with that statement. I think that every single person in every single discipline needs to be involved in issues of climate change and in issues of what's going on in the environment and to our world. I don't think we have the luxury of anyone not being involved. And art is another tool. And it's a tool that I have. It's my most effective tool, I would contend. And I think it pushes at a different, it communicates at a different level. I would say it's a bridge to human emotions. I was really struck by, so I've studied the environment. I was in my undergraduate time in the 80s, 1980s, and which was a time period where there was a lot going on with first coming out with a lot of information about climate change, even though that actually started coming out in the 1800s, but that's a whole nother story. And we're not listening. We're just not listening to scientists. And I was just in this past year listening to the NPR news story. And it was scientists saying, it's time for artists to get involved. No one's listening. We need a different way of communicating. Artists need to step up. And it was that specific. And I can tell you where I was running, listening with headphones in when it was said, And I stopped and I made a note to myself into my phone, I have to get involved with my art. And that's been sort of the genesis. And it was almost like it gave an okay, a nod to me, that sort of, because I think I always had that sense, like the quote you just read of who are artists? And I'm like, no, it's a different way to communicate. And it was very specific also. The quote was, we need new pedestals. And the first thing I created, I actually created the pedestal as well and stuck it on the pedestal. Mm-hmm. So I took it literally. But I think no one needs an okay to be involved, but I think sometimes we need that little bit of a push and be reminded that we all have different tools, and it's my tool.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm going to screen share for just a second here. So let's get some of your work up. This one is called Silent Spring. And tell us what's going on here.
So I decided while working on this grouping of paintings to reread Rachel Carson's Silent Spring, which was written in the year I was born. Which is commented or, you know, used quite often as a beginning of the environmental movement with our understanding of pesticides. And so it was really hard to go back and read it again and say, oh my gosh, in 1962, she was saying all this as a scientist and communicating it very easily with lots, and we weren't listening. We didn't listen to all of it, but she, so in this particular painting, all the pages that you see, well, most of the pages are pages out of Silent Spring. I bought myself a used copy because I wasn't willing to rip up my original copy. And so I bought a used copy, but I wouldn't allow myself to use the pages until I read the chapter. And then they're, you know, it's a sense of these birds that are all part of what's disappearing based on our land use choices and how we're treating the earth. But I also have used, if you could see it really closely, I've also used poetry about nature. So there's both poetry about nature and and the words of Silent Spring in here. And what I wanted to do was give that sense of how much reverence we have for birds and how much we love birds and the beauty. But then the decisions we're making are also how the birds are disappearing because of the decisions we're making. And all the words that are my handwritten words underneath are a synopsis chapter by chapter of Silent Spring. And it's all out of cardboard. So the entire show is all out of cardboard. And that is my choice of not using any new materials. And that everything's impermanent, and every single one of our choices that we make has an impact on Earth.
It looks like this has more three-dimensionality to it too.
It's very three-dimensional, which was a treat to try to figure out. So the birds are flying in towards this nest in the middle, and I've given it an orange glow, as you can see. And part of it is that sense of just the beauty, but also it's a false beauty, you know? And I've just had a lot of fun with the show in all different ways of working with cardboard. And so this is one way that I decided to show it.
Okay, let me then bring up another piece. Who is this guy?
This is a little barred owl.
And what's his name?
Hineni. And Hineni means here I am in Hebrew. And so each of the paintings in the show have a story behind them. That was part of what I tried to do, is to think about what we're not seeing and what, but we are seeing at the same time. What are we missing? And it has to do with, in my mind, when I think about climate change, it's like, can you notice what you're not seeing? So if we're losing species, do we know where they're not there when we can't see them? Are we ignoring the stories that are around us? And so I went to Five Shores, which is a local brewery in Beulah, and they had just had a barred owl release. I missed it by like a minute or two. The North Sky, which is a raptor sanctuary up here, was doing the release, and they had had a large number of barred owls hit by cars right at the same time as daylight savings time. And they said the barred owls are still coming in for food in the mornings, and they're swooping down, and the cars are on the roads at a different time, and earlier because of the change. And the barred owls are getting hit by cars. And so they had in the teens, like 13 barred owls that they were rehabilitating. I was so struck by that. And again, that'd be something I wouldn't have even known if I hadn't arrived at that particular moment and seen that release. So this little barred owl is capturing that story of the release, the cars, the barred owls being hit by cars, and the change in our daylight savings time.
Well, it's obvious that she's watching.
And he's watching. Yes, thank you for that.
You talked a little bit about using cardboard as your canvas. So I know you're no stranger to cardboard or birds, but talk a little bit about how using real common materials. Some people might scratch their heads and say, if you're doing any form of painting, why aren't you using a canvas? So talk about your preference for cardboard and common materials for this particular exhibit.
I really wanted to walk my talk with this exhibit. And so I wanted to use materials that are out there that we are throwing away. I didn't want to buy anything new. I have worked on cardboard before. There is, a question about cardboard. You know, is it impermanent? Well, I would contend that we're all impermanent. Everything's impermanent. And I think there's a lot of beauty in cardboard also, but it's a piece of the a reminder of this is what we're just, it's all packaging material. Everything I've used has come in a box into my house and I've cut it up in some way. Even the papers that I'm using, a lot of it's collage, are all papers that I've created from actually the bottom of my water bucket. So when I pour it out, I work with acrylics and the sediments sink to the bottom. And then I paint the papers the color from the sediments on the bottom. So I'm reusing that instead of flushing it down my sink, which then goes into our well and into the groundwater. I haven't quite figured out how I'm going to frame them or hang them, but it's either going to be with twine or with old pant hangers. So they won't be framed, again, not wanting to create and buy something new. So that, trying to get away from the sense of consumerism and the sense that we can create this way, and we can continue to all walk our talk.
I often think that if we impose the boundary, the limit on ourselves, that we have to use existing materials, that it opens up not a kind of restraint or suffocation, but a whole new area of exploration. Like, okay, I've got this and I have to use it. Now, what can I do with it?
I agree fully. I've had a tremendous amount of fun working with cardboard and papers and making sculptures out of them, putting stones into it. I really like carving. I like carving into the cardboard, the texture. I continue to have ideas, just as you said, or anything that comes into my house. Toilet paper rolls are great. I mean, there's so much to do with toilet paper rolls, but we just throw them away. They can be planters. You can start all your plants in them and put your seeds in the ground that way. I mean, there's so many different things you can do.
I often think that people get caught up in just discombobulated by the vast array of materials there are to purchase, materials and tools there are to purchase. And that sometimes distracts from the making.
I think what I get distracted by is instead how many things I can save. So instead of purchase and think about how can I use this? How can I use this? Because everything has texture.
Yeah. Well, the primary job of a creative practitioner is problem solving.
Definitely.
So you're right on task there.
Yeah.
If you could wave your magic wand, what do you hope that people will take with them from looking at The Birds Are Watching?
A sense that we're all part of this. You know, starting to look at the world a little bit differently, realizing that from a very holistic, you know, perspective, there's a lot of creatures, a lot of the world, Earth is involved and impacted by our movements and what we do on the land, and think about everyone's individual impact. If we went back to the barred owl and the silent spring one, what I've created also, what I've tried to do is a sense of hope within this and a sense of awe. So my goal is if you walked in, you walk in, you see all these paintings, what you're seeing hopefully is just an enjoyment of the paintings and the beauty of the birds. And you feel like you're looking at artwork. And then as you're pulled in and look at that, you realize that there's more going on here. I think we touch people through a sense of awe. You know, I have an awe for nature. It's when I walk in the woods, when I'm watching birds, when I'm walking at Lake Michigan and the beauty of it. And I need that sense of awe and that feeling of beauty to also want to help protect it. So I hope that when people look at my artwork as well and feel touched by nature, they also are touched by that sense of wanting to protect these beings and the earth, and that we're all part of it.
Jessica, thanks. I bet you Dollars to Donuts, you have a website. So if people want to see more work, how do they do that?
It's very easy. It's my name. So jessicacovan.com.
Spell Covan?
K-O-V-A-N.
The Birds Are Watching continues through August 24 in the Art Center's Lobby Gallery. I thank you all for watching, and we'll see you next time.